What's up, you guys? Sean Ross Sapp, Fightful.com, here in Lexington, Impact Wrestling, here with a guy you know, Johnny Swinger. How you doing?
Great. I'm feeling pretty fightful right now myself, actually.
Are
That's
you?
That's what I'm here for.
Well, you're in fighting shape. You're in incredible shape. Everybody's seeing your comeback in Impact Wrestling. How many people did you have hit you up? Like, man, you're back. You're good to go. And you look as good as ever.
Actually, it's been quite the flurry for the last 6 months everywhere I go, which is good. Everybody's talking about Impact Wrestling. It's one of the premier organizations going right now, and I'm just thankful to be a part of it. After all these years coming back to the national scene, I think it's been 13 years since I've been on national TV, so it's pretty cool to be back.
Now, I heard you in a couple different interviews. There was one that you did in L.A. where you talked to Denise, who works with us. You spoke highly of Scott D'Amore and his vision for you in this role. How has it been adapting to this role after so long off TV?
Well, like I said in that interview, I got a lot of faith in Scott. We've been together since day one. He's seen me as a teenager. So I always said that Scott knew how to use Johnny Swinger better than anybody, and I think the proof is in the pudding right here in 2020 that he found a spot for Johnny Swinger, and it's to me has been a super success, and I'm just rolling with it and loving every second of it.
Now, you've been around for decades, so you've seen a lot of different production setups. You've seen a lot of different ways that the companies have done things. How would you, I don't know how to really phrase this. How would you stack up the evolution of this? Because as we're filming this, basically on a handheld camera, a couple of mics, something that maybe wasn't as possible a couple decades ago when you're doing Nitro and all this stuff. Like, we hear about how drones have replaced helicopter shots.
Yeah.
How has that been for you to advance yourself?
Well, like you said, WCW at that time was the biggest production you could see. I mean, it matched Vince McMahon, the WWF. But I went from there to ECW, which was way on the other side. But I also saw how good TV could be produced on a way smaller budget. But coming back in Impact in 2020, I was blown away my debut in Las Vegas when I seen the production that Impact had. The team that they have working behind the scenes is way more than we had in ECW. Actually has some of the proponents in there, Tommy Dreamer and Don Callis. They were some of the brains behind the ECW TV. So real impressed with the team that they assembled for Impact. And that was after signing my contract and coming in for the debut. I was like, wow, I didn't realize it was this. You know, they really had all this together like this.
Yeah, as I stepped in there, I see dozens of people setting up the ring, setting up lighting. Did that surprise you, considering I mean, the way that things have adapted? Like, I mean, you still got to have a pretty big crew to set up a production like this.
For sure. People would never know until they're actually here before the show starts to see what all goes into this. I've been involved in professional wrestling since I was 12 years old, and I can't imagine having to organize all this stuff. I come here and I get ready for my match. I can't imagine, how do you keep track of 85 people going all different ways? Okay, we need this at 2 o'clock, we got this at 4, we're shooting. It's like a movie production set. I don't know how those guys do it. And then even my business, I don't know how they get it all together. And the show comes off without a hitch every time. I've never seen, 6 months that I've been back, I've never seen a major hiccup where like, oh, we were supposed to work that out earlier. It's just smooth, man. They got a bunch of pros working together.
What are some of the things that you've taken from that aspect of places you've worked, the production end of things? And like, are there tricks that you saw that maybe a Paul Heyman would use back then that are being implemented widely now?
I think the I think they call them cutaways.
Yeah.
You know, they're filming something and they know where it's going to end up. But if something goes a little haywire, they know how to switch to something else that's relevant and nobody knows. I think they probably got that from the movie making film industry, but it works. I see that a lot in wrestling now. And I can see where there's always going to be human mistakes. So that's a good way of that I don't think is very expensive or time consuming, that it just makes the show smooth. Yeah, because something's always going to go wrong. Nothing's ever going to come off perfect. But I think the cutaways and like I said, they got experienced people in charge of that, and they know when to do it, and they know if something live is dying, the production people know it. You know what I mean? So they can make an adjustment, and it's like seamless. Nobody, the fans don't know. Only we know. So it's pretty cool.
We see a lot of wrestlers that dip their toes into agenting and stuff like that. Is that something that you've done, or is it something you're interested in?
I've dabbled in that at the independent level. Mm-hmm. I definitely would see that for my future as far as someday when I'm finished on the ring, because eventually everybody's time in the ring is over with. And I enjoy working the business. I would like to continue to do that. And I would like to learn. That's something to learn. That's a new aspect of something I've been doing for almost 30 years to, you know, learn basically a new craft, a new trade associated with what I already do. So you kind of already have like a leg up on that. So, and yeah, I'd like to keep being involved in the wrestling business. So that is definitely the next natural step.
I remember an interview, I want to say it was about a year ago, that you did. And it's almost like you willed the Impact work into existence, because you straight up said, yeah, I'd like to work for Impact Wrestling. And I think it was about a year ago. It was around the time AEW was starting. And you ended up there. How did that feel when you got the call, knowing that it was out there publicly that you wanted to be here?
Yeah. I think, you know, maybe I had a premonition. I don't know. I kind of just from doing something for so long, you can kind of sense things. I didn't sense WWE calling me back, I never called them, but calling me in a sense that I'm not kind of in that loop anymore. I don't know who's in charge of that. I don't know who's running it. They're not people that there's all new people there kind of thing. And I know Cody from when he was 15 years old. That's the last time I saw him. Wow. Maybe one other time since then. So he's not somebody that I would expect to get a call from. But knowing Scott and Don Callis, I also have he was the booker in Winnipeg, Canada when I had my first match ever. So he's another person that I have a super long history with, who is familiar with my talent, how to use it. So I guess I thought if someone asked me, hey, you know, where would you go, Impact, AEW or WWE, just Impact would make the most sense. And then, you know, words become flesh, so to speak.
Johnny, let the people know where they can follow you on social media.
I'm not as up to it as the young guys. It's kind of my gimmick, so to speak. But you can find me on Facebook like everybody else. Instagram, Johnny_Swinger. And I do my best to get on there and try to stay up with what's going on. And, hey, we all got to evolve. I'm not going 100%, but, you know, even 30 or 40 is pretty good for me.
You can also find him every Tuesday on Access TV, Impact Wrestling. Until next time, guys, we're out.